It's Academy Awards season, the time of year when Hollywood elites can give themselves a pat on the back for a job well done and flaunt their success to millions of plebeians around the world. This year, the ceremony is being hosted by Hugh Jackman. Famous for his role as Wolverine in the X-Men film series, you might not realize that Mr. Jackman is also quite the singer, having starred in musicals like Oklahoma and Boy from Oz prior to 2005. Now, the award show this year is set to have a big, bombastic opening musical number sung by Hugh. During rehearsals for this song, two producers remark that Mr. Jackman reminds them of P.T. Barnum. Overhearing this, Hugh expresses interest in working on a project or film about P.T. Barnum, and so Mark and Condon contact Jenny Bix, and she sets to work with Condon on writing a script. The Greatest Showman is announced in 2009, with Hugh Jackman already slated to star in the film. Meet Jeremy Jordan. A talented actor and vocalist, Jeremy is busy on the theater scene. Fresh off of his run as Jack Kelly, the leading role in Disney's historical drama musical Newsies, Jeremy is currently filming on the CW's television show Supergirl at a studio in Los Angeles, when all of a sudden, ring ring, his phone buzzes, and he answers it. It's his good friends, Benj Pasek and Justin Paul, a duo of composers who you may recognize for their work writing the music of Dear Evan Hansen. They say, "Hey Jeremy, we're working with Hugh Jackman on a movie musical about P.T. Barnum." "Oh, P.T. Barnum the Carney Con?" "Yes Jeremy, P.T. Barnum the Carney Con. And we need someone to come in and record vocal demos for the songs we've written so far." "Sounds good, count me in." He obliges Pasek and Paul and records the demos. Jeremy finds this project appealing, desiring to portray the role of Barnum's partner in crime, Philip Carlyle. A few months pass without any development. 2016 rolls around. Jeremy is sick with a terrible sinus infection. He has lost the ability to sing, much less speak. His phone rings again. "Hey there, Jeremy. It's the producers of The Greatest Showman. We're about to have a workshop of the script in front of a bunch of executives. Hugh Jackman is going to be there playing the role of Barnum, of course. It's going to be really cool. If the executives really like this movie, we will get it greenlit. Anyways, we were wondering if you'd like to come and play the role of Philip Carlyle for this presentation. Now, of course, we don't have the funds to fly you out for the presentation, but if you can find a way to get over here yourself, we're all ready for you." Now here he is, 3 days before the presentation. He is set to play a vital male supporting role in a make-or-break workshop for a potentially new musical movie, and Jeremy Jordan cannot sing. Excited, if not queasy, Jeremy takes a day off of Supergirl, buys himself a plane ticket, and flies out to New York. This is a man on a mission, and by golly, he's gonna take control of his own destiny. He pops a few prednisone pills, prays for a quick recovery, and goes to sleep. His phone vibrates. It's a message from his old friends, Pasek and Paul. "Hey Jeremy, it's us again. Change of plans. You see, our star Hugh Jackman just got back from the hospital. He had to have an emergency surgery on his nose to remove a small tumor. The doctors are saying that he absolutely cannot sing or the stitches will rip.
Furthermore, the composer, who's also a great singer, had also lost his voice, and the only person that would be there and knew all the songs and could sing them was me. They asked me if I could stand to the side and sing all of Hugh's songs while he stood front and center and acted them out. Oh, and also sing all of my character Phillips' scenes and songs as well. Basically, do all the parts, be perfect, and your only hope to make sure the presentation goes smoothly and that they fund our major motion picture, no pressure.
The day of the workshop arrives. It's all up to Jeremy now. He stands up with Hugh Jackman and begins to sing the Act 1 opening number. The majority of this first act goes without a hitch. Jeremy and Hugh work their way through the songs relatively well. But Jeremy is still sick, and that prednisone is wearing out. His voice grows fatigued. Now, it's important to remember here that Jeremy not only has to sing on behalf of Hugh Jackman, but also act and sing as Philip Carlyle. Act 2 rolls around, and Jeremy has a big, show-stopping duet as Philip Carlyle, titled Rewrite the Stars. This is a duet with the female lead of the show.
We get to the song, my butt cheeks are as clenched as possible. And I will now reenact for you exactly what happened. How do
He struggles his way through and emerges out the other end feeling devastated. But maybe there's some hope.
We're nearing the end. And don't forget, I'm still singing all of Hugh's songs! And we get to his big 11 o'clock number, this number that he sings called From Now On. And I remember pepping up a little bit because the number, as I recall, started out low, and it built, and it built, and it built, but it didn't build to a point that was so high that I couldn't reach it in my current state. And I got really excited thinking, this is gonna be my redemption moment. I'm gonna go in there and kick this song's ass and leave this place flying high, dignity intact. The song starts. I'm ready to go. I saw the sun begin to dim. I felt that when our wind blow cold. It's feeling pretty good. A man learns who is there for him. When the glitter fades and the walls won't hold. I'm feeling very confident now. People are looking at me, they're not even looking at you. Who's that guy? Cause from that struggle, what remains can only be words true. And suddenly there's like a bus light next to me. If all was lost, there's more I've gained. And I look over, cause it led me back to you. And Hugh is looking very antsy, and I'm like, does he need to go to the bathroom? What's going on? From now on, these eyes will not be blinded by the light. And he starts nodding at me, and I'm like, I don't know what you want. From now on, what's waited, oh shit, till tomorrow starts to know. Don't do it, Hugh, don't do it.
Let this promise in me start, like an anthem in my heart. From now on, from now on.
Unable to contain himself much longer, he cuts off Jeremy mid-lyric and takes over. The music ramps up, emotions run high, and Wolverine belts like his life depends on it, moving the cast and crew to tears and bursting his stitches in the process.
Politicians praise my name.
The song ends, the executives erupt with applause, and the movie is greenlit. Jeremy Jordan stands still, dumbfounded.
And I played along like a champ, but inside I was crushed. Turns out it was not my redemption moment. No, it was his. It was his all along. And the song ends, and the applause is deafening. The spirits are high. The movie is greenlit. And I got out of there as fast as humanly possible. But not before hearing somebody whisper that Hugh had just met with Zac Efron about the part of Philip. And just like that, I slammed shut the chapter in my life, tentatively titled The Greatest Showman, and I have not opened it since.
Nowadays, Mr. Jordan has moved on. He has become a father, and he works on raising his child as he continues work in the theater. He's been part of various cast recordings and shows in that time. Come what may, though, this man single-handedly saved The Greatest Showman. And while he may not receive the recognition for his efforts that he so righteously deserves, he's still a champion, nonetheless. And to me, Jeremy Jordan will always be the true greatest showman.